This is part 8 of Dimensions, a casebook of alien contact. A book by Jacques Vallée. Please listen with an open mind.
The functioning lie. What does it all mean? Is it reasonable to draw a parallel between religious apparitions, the fairy faith, the reports of dwarf-like beings with supernatural powers, the airship tales in the United States in the last century, and the present stories of UFO landings? I would strongly argue that it is, for one simple reason. The mechanisms that have generated the various beliefs are identical. Their human context and their effect on humans are constant. The observation of this very deep mechanism is crucial. It has little to do with the problem of knowing whether UFOs are physical objects or not. Attempting to understand the meaning, the purpose, of the so-called flying saucers, as many people are doing today, is just as futile as was the pursuit of the fairies, if one makes the mistake of confusing appearance and reality. The phenomenon has stable, invariant features, some of which we have tried to identify and label clearly. But we have also had to note carefully the chameleon-like character of the secondary attributes of the sightings, the shapes of the objects, the appearances of their occupants, and their reported statements vary as a function of the cultural environment into which they are projected. As we have seen with the airship stories in Chapter 2, a good number of bearded characters alighted in the Midwest and elsewhere in 1897 to request water from a well, bluestones, or other similar things. The stories witnesses told were believable, if somewhat astounding, to American farmers of the time. The airship itself corresponded to the popular concept of an elaborate flying machine. It had wheels, turbines, wings, powerful lights. There is only one detail not yet dealt with. The fact that the airship, though believable to the witnesses of 1897, is no longer credible to us. We know that the device as described could not possibly fly, unless its outside appearance was designed to deceive potential witnesses. But if so, why? And what was it? What was the purpose of such a simulacrum? Perhaps the airship, like the fairy tricks and the flying saucers, was a lie so well engineered that its image could sink very deep into human consciousness and then be forgotten, as UFO landings are periodically forgotten, as the appearances of supernatural beings in the Middle Ages are forgotten. But, then, are they really forgotten? Human actions are based on imagination, belief, and faith, not on objective observation, as military and political experts know well. Even science, which claims its methods and theories are rationally developed, is shaped by emotion and fancy, or by fear. And to control human imagination is to shape mankind's collective destiny. Beyond the question of the physical nature of the UFOs, it is imperative that we study the deeper problem of their impact on our imagination and culture. How the UFO phenomena will affect, in the long run, our views about science, about religion, about the exploration of space, is impossible to measure. But the phenomenon does appear to have a real effect. And a peculiar feature of this mechanism is that it affects equally those who believe and those who oppose its reality in a physical sense. For the time being, the observation can be made that it is possible to make large sections of any population believe in the existence of supernatural races, in the possibility of flying machines, in the plurality of inhabited worlds, by exposing them to a few carefully engineered scenes, the details of which are adapted to the culture and symbols of a particular time and place. Could the meetings with UFO entities be designed to control our beliefs? Consider their changing character. In the United States, they appear as science fiction monsters. In South America, they are sanguinary and quick to get into a fight. In France, they behave like rational, Cartesian, peace-loving tourists. The Irish gentry, if we believe its spokesman, was an aristocratic race organized somewhat like a religious military order. The airship pilots were strongly individualistic characters with all the features of the American farmer. Now consider the following case, which illustrates the same point. The date is October 23, 1954, and the place is near Tripoli, Libya. About 3 a.m. an Italian farmer saw a flying craft land a few dozen yards from him. It was shaped like an egg laid horizontally. The upper half was transparent and flooded with very white light, the lower half appeared to be metallic. The forepart had two side ports, the central part had an external ladder. The hind part had two vertically disposed wheels, one above the other, and two cylindrical protruding tubes. While descending, the craft made a noise similar to that of a compressor like those used for inflating car tires. No propeller was visible. The fuselage was surrounded by two antennae, one behind the other, and bore a kind of undercarriage with six wheels, two pairs in the fore part of the craft, one pair behind. The machine was about 6 yards long and 3 yards wide. Inside it were six men in yellowish coveralls wearing gas masks. One of them took his mask off in order to blow into a sort of tube. His face appeared to be that of a normal human being. When the witness got close to the object and put a hand on the ladder, a strong electric shock threw him to the ground. One of the occupants made gestures as if to warn him, for his sake, to keep away from the craft. Another occupant pulled out a wheel and again put it back where it formerly was. Then, pushing a button, he caused a kind of half container to cover the wheels. Inside the cockpit, a kind of radio set, complete with wires and operated by a man with earphones, was visible. All six pilots were busy on their instrument panels. The incident lasted about 20 minutes. The object silently took off and reached an altitude of 50 yards. Then it went east at a dizzying speed. The imprints left by the undercarriage's wheels on the soft ground have been photographed. They resembled those of normal rubber wheels. Their length was only about 2 feet. If it were possible to make three-dimensional holograms with mass, and to project them through time, I would say this is what the farmer saw. And with that theory we would explain many of the apparitions. In numerous UFO cases and in some religious miracles, the beings appeared as three-dimensional images whose feet did not actually touch the ground. But what about the other physical actions, such as the electric shocks? As we read the account of the Libyan landing case, it is tempting to assume that the farmer, far from witnessing by chance the maneuvers of interplanetary visitors, was deliberately exposed to a scene designed to be recorded by him and transmitted to us, hence, the gas masks, the instrument panels, and the radio set complete with wires. The same is true with the following Italian case, which took place in Abbiate Bozzone, near Varese, on April 24, 1950, at about 10 p.m. Bruno Facchini heard and saw sparks which he attributed to a storm, but he soon discovered a dark mass hovering between a pole and a tree 200 yards from his house. A man dressed in tight-fitting clothes and wearing a helmet appeared to be making repairs. There were three other figures working around the huge craft. This work being over, a trap through which light had been shining was closed, and the thing took off. Other details were as follows. The object made a sound similar to that of a giant beehive and the air seemed strangely warm around it. Two of the men were standing on the ground near a ladder, the third one was on a telescopic elevator, the base of which touched the ground, and was holding something near a group of pipes. This produced the sparks seen by Facchini. They were about 5 feet 9 inches tall, dressed in gray diving suits with an oval transparent glass in front of their faces, which were concealed behind gray masks. From the fore portion of the masks a flexible pipe emerged at the level of the mouth. They wore earphones. Inside the craft could be seen a series of oxygen-type containers and many dials. When Facchini offered his help, the men talked among themselves in guttural sounds, and one of them took a camera-like device from around his neck and projected a beam of light on Facchini, who tumbled away for several yards. He was then caught by a rush of air and thrown again to the ground. They subsequently ignored him as they recovered the elevator and brought it inside the craft, which took off. After a sleepless night, Facchini returned to the site and found some metal fragments left by the soldering operation, also four circular imprints and patches of scorched grass. He revealed the observation only 10 days later, when his doctor treated him for the pains and bruises resulting from his fall and advised him to call police. Ministry of Defense technicians who examined the metal samples found them to consist of an anti-friction material very resistant to heat. The incident had other witnesses, who testified privately. Had Mr. Facchini been exposed deliberately to a faked apparition of space beings? What could be the purpose of such an elaborate hoax? Who can afford to contrive such a complex scheme, for so little apparent result? Is human imagination alone capable of playing such tricks on itself? Or should we hypothesize that an advanced race somewhere in the universe and sometime in the future has been showing us three-dimensional space operas for the last 2,000 years, in an attempt to guide our civilization? If so, do they deserve our congratulations? Are we dealing instead with a parallel universe, another dimension, where there are human races living, and where we may go at our expense, never to return to the present? Are these races only semi-human, so that in order to maintain contact with us, they need crossbreeding with men and women of our planet? Is this the origin of the many tales and legends where genetics plays a great role, the symbolism of the virgin in occultism and religion, the fairy tales involving human midwives and changelings, the sexual overtones of the flying saucer reports, the biblical stories of intermarriage between the Lord's angels and terrestrial women, whose offspring were giants? From that mysterious universe, are higher being projecting objects that can materialize and dematerialize at will? Are the UFOs windows rather than objects? There is nothing to support these assumptions, and yet, in view of the historical continuity of the phenomenon, alternatives are hard to find, unless we deny the reality of all the facts, as our peace of mind would indeed prefer. The problem cannot be solved yet. If we absolutely must have something to believe, then we should join one of the numerous groups of people who have all the answers. Read Menzel's books or the Condon Report, that fine piece of scientific recklessness. Or subscribe to the magazines that prove that flying saucers are real and from outer space. I am not writing for such people, but for those few who have gone through all this and have graduated to a higher, cleaner level of perception of the total meaning of that tenuous dream that underlies the many nightmares of human history. For those who have recognized the delicate levers of the collective unconscious. Conjectures. It may seem useless to conjecture about a mystery that, according to all evidence, remains unidentified. But in this book we have already seen that the UFO phenomenon has left a clear series of marks in the beliefs and attributes of our contemporaries, in a pattern not only identifiable but also by no means unprecedented. It is not pointless to try to devise critical tests, both sociological and physical, to determine whether or not purposeful design is involved in the phenomena the witnesses describe. Whenever a set of unusual circumstances is presented, it is in the nature of the human mind to analyze it until a rational pattern is encountered at some level. But it is quite conceivable that nature should present us with circumstances so deeply organized that our observational and logical errors would entirely mask the pattern to be identified. To the scientist, there is nothing surprising in this statement. The history of science consists in dual progress, the refinement of observational techniques and the improvement of analytical methods. On the other hand, the proposition that the universe might contain intelligent creatures exhibiting such an organization that no model of it could be constructed on the basis of current human concepts is also theoretically plausible. The behavior of such beings would necessarily appear random or absurd or would go undetected, especially if these beings possessed physical means of retiring at will beyond the human perceptual range, or into other dimensions. Such physical actions would appear on scientific records as mere random accidents, easily ascribable to instrumental error or to a variety of natural causes. Considering the UFO phenomenon as a special instance of that more fundamental question, we are presented with the dual possibility of very long-term unsolvability and continued manifestation, and this is true whether the phenomenon is natural or artificial in nature. The development of a new myth feeding upon this duality is entirely predictable. In the absence of a rational solution to the mystery, and due to intense public interest, it is quite likely that in coming years every brand of charlatanism will use it as a base, although it is not possible to predict its exact form. We may very well be living the early years of a new mythological movement, and it may eventually give our technological age its Olympus or its Valhalla, whether we regard such a development as an asset or as a blow to our culture. Because many observations of UFO phenomena appear self-consistent and at the same time irreconcilable with scientific knowledge, a logical vacuum has been created that human imagination tries to fill with fantasy. Such situations have been frequently observed in the past, and they have given us both the highest and the basest forms of religious, poetic, and political activity. It is entirely possible that the UFO phenomenon will give rise to similar developments, because its manifestations coincide with a renewal of interest in the human value of technology. It is precisely because science is the process through which unsolvable emotional arguments can be transformed into organized sets of sub-problems amenable to rational analysis that the UFO phenomenon is interesting. Therefore, to say that UFOs are not a scientific problem, or even to pose the question of whether they are or not, is to utter an absurdity. There is no such thing as a scientific problem, it is the man who looks at the problem who is or is not scientific in his approach. Science is an object in the human mind, not a characteristic we are at liberty either to bestow upon or to withdraw from every funny-looking contraption that happens to cross our skies. For a scientist, the only valid question is to decide whether the phenomenon can be studied by itself, or whether it is an instance of a deeper problem. This book attempts to illustrate, and only to illustrate, the latter approach. And my conclusion is that, through the UFO phenomenon, we have the unique opportunities to observe folklore in the making and to gather scientific material at the deepest source of human imagination. We will be the object of much contempt by future students of our civilization if we allow this material to be lost, for tradition is a meteor which, once it falls, cannot be rekindled. If we decide to avoid extreme speculation, but make certain basic observations from the existing data, five principal facts stand out rather clearly from our analysis so far. Fact 1. There has been among the public, in all countries, since the middle of 1946, an extremely active generation of colorful rumors. They center on a considerable number of observations of unknown machines close to the ground in rural areas, the physical traces left by these machines, and their various effects on humans and animals. Fact 2. When the underlying archetypes are extracted from these rumors, the extraterrestrial myth is seen to coincide to a remarkable degree with the fairy faith of Celtic countries, the observations of the scholars of past ages, and the widespread belief among all peoples concerning entities whose physical and psychological description place them in the same category as the present-day UFOnauts. Fact 3. The entities human witnesses report to have seen, heard, and touched fall into various biological types. Among them are beings of giant stature, men indistinguishable from us, winged creatures, and various types of monsters. Most of the so-called pilots, however, are dwarfs and form two main groups: 1, dark, hairy beings, identical to the gnomes of medieval theory, with small, bright eyes and deep, rugged, old voices, and 2, beings, who answer the description of the sylphs of the Middle Ages or the elves of the fairy faith, with human complexions, oversized heads, and silvery voices. All the beings have been described with and without breathing apparatus. Beings of various categories have been reported together. The overwhelming majority are humanoid. Fact 4. The entities' reported behavior is as consistently absurd as the appearance of their craft is ludicrous. In numerous instances of verbal communications with them, their assertions have been systematically misleading. This is true for all cases on record, from encounters with the gentry in the British Isles to conversations with airship engineers during the 1897 Midwest flap and discussions with the alleged Martians in Europe, North, and South America, and elsewhere. This absurd behavior has had the effect of keeping professional scientists away from the area where that activity was taking place. It has also served to give the saucer myth its religious and mystical overtones. Fact 5. The mechanism of the apparitions, in legendary, historical, and modern times, is standard and follows the model of religious miracles. Several cases, which bear the official stamp of the Catholic Church, such as those in Fatima and Guadalupe, are in fact, if one applies the definition strictly, nothing more than UFO phenomena where the entity has delivered a message having to do with religious beliefs rather than with space or engineering. Given the above five facts, I believe the following three propositions to be true. Proposition 1. The behavior of a superior race would not necessarily appear purposeful to a human observer. Scientists who brush aside UFO reports because obviously intelligent visitors would not behave like that simply have not given serious thought to the problem of non-human intelligence. Observation and deduction agree, in fact, that the organized action of a superior race must appear absurd to the inferior one. That this does not preclude contact and even cohabitation is an obvious fact of daily life on our planet, where humans, animals, and insects have interwoven activities in spite of their different levels of nervous system organization. Proposition 2. If we recognize that the structure and nature of time is as much of a puzzle to modern physicists as it was to Reverend Kirk, for example, then it follows that any theory of the universe that does not take our ignorance into account is bound to remain an academic exercise. Proposition 3. The entire mystery we are discussing contains all the elements of a myth that could be utilized to serve long-term social manipulation purposes, as illustrated by the curious link between the contents of the reports and the progress of human technology, from aerial ships to dirigibles to ghost rockets to flying saucers and to biogenetic engineering, a link that has never received a satisfactory interpretation in a sociological framework. With respect to the last point, I find it remarkable that the first instance of a blackout caused by a UFO should be found in Twilight Bar, a play written by Arthur Koestler in 1933. During the play, which takes place on a small unnamed island where civil war is about to break out, an enormous meteor flies over the town with a high-pitched whistling sound as all the lights go out. The craft plunges into the sea, and two beings, dressed in white coveralls and moving as if in a trance, come ashore and introduce themselves as messengers sent to warn mankind that it has 3 short days in which to mend its ways. Otherwise, the creatures say, mankind will be destroyed and the earth will be repopulated by a superior race. The first reference to UFO effects on car ignition came in a novel written in 1950 by Bernard Newman entitled The Flying Saucer. It is true that when Newman's book was written, some UFO reports involving magnetic disturbances of the compass were already circulating. Even in 1944, the military had already amassed considerable information about unidentified flying objects, the first large-scale scientific investigation having been done by the National Bureau of Standards the previous year. But the fact remains that the coincidence between these works of imagination and the actual details of the reports that came from the public is a remarkable one, and it opens the way to unlimited speculation. Knowledge of the structure of time would imply superior knowledge of destiny. I am using the word destiny to designate not the fate of individuals but the mechanism through which physical events unfold and the canvas upon which they are implemented. Before we go on to the question of the psychic component of the experience, perhaps I also should remind the reader of 2 points we have touched upon earlier. 1. The relativity of time in Magonia, a theory passed on to us in numerous tales we have reviewed, and 2. That astonishing little remark made by a sylph to Phaseus Cardan, which antedates quantum theory by 4 centuries. He added that God created the universe from moment to moment, so that should he desist for an instant the world would perish. As Jerome Cardan says, be this fact or fable, so it stands. 6. The psychic component, metalogic. Return of a specter. It is difficult for the public to tolerate a mystery that refuseth to die. When encounters with unidentified flying objects were suddenly reported all over the United States during the first half of October 1973, after 7 quiet years, and when 2 men from Pascagoula, Mississippi, told their tale of abduction by grotesque robot-like creatures, the public recognized the return of a specter that science had pronounced dead and buried with great pomp just a few years before. The burial had been performed by the University of Colorado at the cost of $500,000, and the 800-page postmortem had clearly stated that the study of UFOs cannot be justified in the expectation that science will be advanced thereby. Professor Edward Condon, who led the study, felt so strongly about the uselessness of the whole thing that he destroyed the project files. 3 days before his death, in March 1974, he was still urging a physicist friend to drop his study of UFOs. When Condon was told that a documentary was being prepared, he advocated that all the footage be burned. The Air Force subsequently closed down its own public relations office for the monitoring of sighting reports, Project Blue Book, with a similar declaration. When the sightings again filled the world press, it became clear that the subject of UFOs was as alive as ever. It was easy for flying saucer enthusiasts everywhere to exclaim, "We told you so." But it was not easy for the witnesses to understand what they had seen, and it was even harder for them to forget it. Some never will. A husband and wife who drove a truck in the Midwest were fired from their job when they reported that an object had followed them along a Missouri road one October night, emitting a burst of light that blinded the husband, inducing some loss of eyesight, and caused the plastic frame of his glasses to melt. Like the Pascagoula story of robot-like monsters, the facts were unbelievable to local scientists who examined them out of the context of the overall phenomenon. Professor Condon had had the same problem. Incredibly, all the members of his team had been selected because they had no previous knowledge of the subject. Yet it is only when one analyzes the thousands of similar occurrences in the last 40 years and in all countries that one achieves some degree of understanding. During the 1970s, the report of paranormal events in connection with close encounters with UFOs seems to have become the rule rather than the exception, and most investigators have found it very difficult to deal with this aspect of the cases because it does not match their expectation of what an extraterrestrial visit would be. Such paranormal events might take the form of minor unexplained coincidences in which a man might have had a dream prior to the sighting, or answered a knock on the door only to find no one there, as happened to a policeman who later the same evening reported being paralyzed by two occupants of an unknown craft. Sometimes the event was more significant. A number of witnesses, for example, reported perceiving distinct messages inside their heads, a fact they interpreted as an indication of a telepathic ability on the part of the UFO occupants. Still other categories of psychic events are the distortions of time and space reported by witnesses and the apparent violations of physical laws represented by the sudden appearance and disappearance of physical craft. And as we saw in previous chapters, close observers often report something akin to a trip into a parallel time stream. These observations constitute collectively what I call the psychic component of the UFO phenomenon. Another aspect of the sightings that I find interesting is the very same aspect that has made scientists from other disciplines turn away in disgust. I am referring to their apparent absurdity. My field of research is the nature of information, its use by people, its transliteration in the form of documents, its application to artificial intelligence, and its representation in the behavior of automata. The techniques of this field can be used for compiling observations, sorting them out, classifying them, and looking for new patterns. A few scientists are pursuing this task in spite of the apparent absurdity of the data. Their work to unravel the UFO enigma centers increasingly on the psychic component of the reports that is indicative either of actual communication with the witness or of direct influence unexplainable by ordinary physical means, over the accelerator. In the foothills of the California Coastal Range, just west of the city of Menlo Park where the Stanford Linear Accelerator plunges straight under the newly constructed expressway, there is a spot of unusual beauty. It is situated within a mile or so of a densely populated area, yet it gives one a feeling of utter loneliness. The linear accelerator stretches deep into this valley, guarded by wire fences, yet the fields around it have kept a sort of bucolic charm. Where the accelerator ends, there is a funnel-shaped depression that is not visible from the road. It is from that depression that a man saw an unusual object rise one evening in February 1972. The man was first attracted to the object by a humming sound it made. Let us note once again that humming sounds, buzzing noises, and sounds compared to the swarming of bees are commonly reported as the auditory perception associated with a UFO. He stopped his car, and he and his companion got out. The hum became more distinct as the object came into view. It was glowing red. It flew in a straight line up the hill, as if following the roof of the elongated tunnel. Then it flew down again and was lost from sight in the valley. But not for long. It soon came back into view, and this time it took off, rising very high and very fast as it passed overhead. The two men below saw it clearly. It was somewhat like looking directly at the sun, they said, although contours of the light were sharp. The impression was not like observing a strong projector attached to a flying object, it was more like looking through a window that opened on the inside of a star. The witness who told me this story mentioned having previously seen unidentified objects. On a certain occasion in Montana, he had observed two disc-shaped craft crossing his path, and they had come to hover in a field. He walked toward them and approached within 75 feet. He had the intense feeling of being under observation, even at that distance. He used the word communication. But how could you tell? I asked him. You have mentioned no window, no indication that there was life on these objects. Have you ever been close to a whale? The witness asked me, implying that he had the vague feeling that the object somehow was aware of him, as a wild animal is aware of, but appears to ignore, the presence of a person. Do not report this. Accounts such as the one I have just quoted abound in a corner of the psychic house that too few people interested in paranormal phenomena ever take the trouble to visit. In the last 25 years, at least 10,000 sightings of unidentified flying objects have been filed away unexplained by competent investigators. I am not referring here to the number of cases reported but only to those unsolved, and my figure is a conservative one, but no bridge has yet been built between this body of data and the evidence that exists for psychic phenomena such as precognition, psychokinesis, and telepathy. Such a bridge is needed, not only because current research on parapsychology could shed light on some of the more mystifying UFO incidents, but also because in return, an understanding of the nature of the UFO phenomenon could provide new insights into unusual events that have not yet been duplicated in the laboratory. It would give a clue to the mechanism of some psychic processes. The nature of the problem can be illustrated by another example, a report given to me by a woman living in Berkeley, California, who once observed a series of five round objects crossing the sky over East San Francisco Bay. She immediately thought they must be balloons. Then the first one accelerated and, upon reaching a certain spot, shot straight out of sight at an unbelievable speed. The second object did the same a few moments later. Then the third object dashed ahead and vanished in the sky. And the fourth, and finally the fifth. The sky was again empty. But in the mind of the witness there was a strange thought, the strong suggestion that this was all right for her to see. This was accompanied by another thought which almost came as an explicit message, this was nothing that she should report. And, indeed, she went home without breathing a word of the event to anyone, until she attended a lecture where I raised the question of the possibility of unconscious or repressed contact. How frequently witnesses decide to withhold this kind of information has already been noted. If we disregard the last part of the woman's testimony, she is simply another person among millions of Americans who believe that, at one time or another, they have seen a UFO. But do we have a right to disregard that section of her report? And what happens if we take into consideration the fact that she distinctly felt a direct imperative message had been implanted in her mind, and that it was as much a part of the occurrence as her sensory observation of five luminous objects? What happens if we examine the files of sightings with an open mind regarding such psychic components? We find that phenomena of precognition, telepathy, and even healing are not unusual among the reports, especially when they involve close-range observation of an object or direct exposure to its light. The case of Dr. X. The following case is among the most thoroughly investigated accounts of the interaction between human percipients, those who have perceived the phenomenon by whatever means, and the phenomenon of UFOs. It involves a medical doctor who holds an official position in southern France. What is unusual about this case, which occurred the night of November 1, 1968, is that competent investigators, including an astrophysicist, a psychiatrist, and a physiologist, were able to gain rapid access to the data and to monitor the development of subsequent events without interference from the press or from government authorities. The witness wants absolutely no publicity in connection with his experiences. Neither his patients nor his immediate family know of the events. Shortly before 4 a.m., the doctor was awakened by the calls of his 14-month-old baby. Experiencing some pain because 3 days earlier he had injured his leg while chopping wood and still had a large hematoma, an area of accumulated blood under the skin, he got up and found the baby gesturing toward the window with excitement. Through the shutters, the doctor saw what he first took to be flashes of lightning, but he paid little attention to this, gave a bottle of water to the baby, and went on to inspect the house, for it was raining very hard, though no thunder could be heard. The light flashes continued, coming from the western part of the wide landscape that can be seen from the south of the house, which is built on the side of a hill. Opening a large window that leads onto the terrace, the witness first observed the objects. There were two of them, disc-shaped, horizontal, silvery white on top and bright red underneath. Other details of the objects that the doctor was later able to recall include horizontal antennae and a vertical antennae on top, while a perfectly cylindrical beam of white light illuminated the mist under the discs. The flashes, which occurred with a periodicity of about 1 second, were marked by a brief increase in the luminosity of both disks, followed by a sudden burst of light between them. The objects were moving in unison toward the left, that is, toward the center of the doctor's field of view, and they were coming closer, their apparent size increasing while the object that seemed farthest away came to align itself with the closer one. While they were still approaching, following the trajectory of the beams on the ground enabled the witness to ascertain that they were indeed coming closer. These two disks went through a remarkable transformation, their antennae came into contact, the two beams interpenetrated, the flashing activity stopped, and the two craft merged. There was now a single disk, directly facing the window and still coming nearer, with a single beam of white light underneath. After a time, the witness is unable to recall how long, the disk began flipping from a horizontal to a vertical position, until it was seen as a circle standing on edge. The shaft of light, which had been drawn by the rotation into a sweeping movement toward the house, came to illuminate the entire front and shone straight into the doctor's face. At that instant a bang was heard and the disk went away, leaving behind a whitish glow which was slowly blown away by the wind. After these events, the witness wrote a detailed account of his sighting, with sketches. He awoke his wife and told her what had happened. At that point it was she who observed, with considerable amazement, that the swelling and pain in his leg had completely disappeared. In the days that followed, he became aware that all the after effects of a wound he had received during the Algerian War had also dissipated. French science writer Amy Michel, a researcher with the French Radio and Television Organization, visited the witness on November 8, 6 days after the sighting, and found him tired. He had lost weight since the observation and was very distressed by what had happened to him. That same day he experienced cramps and pains in the abdomen, and a red pigmentation appeared around the navel, forming a triangle. By November 17, the seemingly preposterous phenomenon was well developed. Examinations by a dermatologist led to negative results, but the specialist was so intrigued by this triangular pigmentation without a cause that he decided to document it as a report to the French Academy of Medicine. The witness, who had not told the specialist that everything had started with his observation of a UFO, requested that on the contrary he given the phenomenon no publicity. During the night of November 13th to 14th, the doctor had had a dream in which a triangular pattern was seen connected with a flying disc. The same triangle appeared on the baby's stomach a day or so after the witness's examination. The psychosomatic explanation first proposed by Amy Michel had to be discarded. When the investigator, who kept the witness under close observation, published the results of his 2-year follow-up of the case, he noted that there had been no recurrence of either the war sequelae or the wound on the leg. The peculiar triangle, however, continued to come and go on both the father and the son, and would stay visible for 2 or 3 days at a time, even when the child was away and staying with his grandmother, who knew nothing of the sighting and was very much alarmed when she saw the triangular pigmentation. The recurrence of the triangle was observed every year and was again recorded on film in 1986. Like the grandmother, friends of the family still know nothing, but they have noted a change in the mental attitudes of the doctor and his wife. They seem to have acquired an almost mystical acceptance of the events of life and death, which is puzzling to those who had known them previously. Finally, there is the matter of the paranormal phenomena that now take place around them. Coincidences of a telepathic nature are frequently reported, and the doctor has allegedly, on at least one occasion, experienced levitation without being able to control it. Clocks and electrical circuits have been affected, apparently without cause. Such phenomena are not unprecedented. Cases of uncontrolled levitation or gravity effects have been reported in connection with UFOs. In one case, which took place in 1954 in the French countryside, a man who was coming back from the fields with his horse had to let go of the bridle as the animal was lifted several feet into the air. A dark, circular object was flying fast over the trail they were following. Neither is the change in life patterns an uncommon fact among witnesses of close encounters with such objects. An awareness of the paranormal has been inspired by such sightings in men like Edgar Casey. As a child, Casey met a woman who appeared out of a sphere of radiant light and told him that he would be able to heal the sick when he grew up. In the words of Thomas Sugrue, As soon as the weather was good, he went back to his retreat in the woods. There, one afternoon in May, he became aware of the presence of someone else. He looked up. A woman was standing before him. "Your prayers have been heard," she said. "Tell me what you would like most of all, so that I may give it to you." "Most of all, I would like to be helpful to others, and especially to children when they are sick." Suddenly she was no longer there. He looked at the place where she had stood, trying to see her in the beams of light, but she was gone. Edgar Cayce's sighting is reminiscent of several cases that fall into the category of religious experiences, although the initial observation is often linked to an unusual flying object, as in the miracles of Lourdes and Fatima, which we will analyze in Chapter 7, and in the visions that led to the founding of the Mormon Church. Such miracles often give to the percipients healing or prophetic powers. Metalogic. What do we know of the nature of the communication that is reported to occur between human witnesses and the occupants of the UFOs? I have earlier commented that, on the surface, such communication appears to be simply absurd. The word absurd, however, is misleading. I prefer the expression metalogical. When a witness meets a UFO occupant who asks, "What time is it?" and replies, "It's 2:30, only to be bluntly told, "You lie, it is 4 o'clock, this actually happened in France in 1954, the story is not simply absurd. It has a symbolic meaning beyond the apparent contradiction of the dialogue. Could it be that the true meaning of the dialogue is time is not what you think it is, or any measurement of time can only be relative? In 1961, similarly, Barney Hill found himself trying to explain to the humanoid examining him that time was an important concept for us on Earth. The humanoid appeared not to understand what he meant. The point of these incidents seems to have been to convey the fact that consciousness transcended time itself. Situations such as these often have the deep poetic and paradoxical quality of Eastern religious tales. What is the sound of one hand clapping? And the mystical expressions of the Kabbalah, such as references to a dark flame. If you strive to convey a truth that lies beyond the semantic level made possible by your audience's language, you must construct apparent contradictions in terms of ordinary meaning. In the above contact case in France, the next question was about space and again was absurd. "Am I in Italy or Germany?" asked the UFO pilot. What scientist would take such a story seriously? Even a priest might avoid it, for fear of demons. In fact, some witnesses have thought they had seen demons because the creature had the unpredictability and mischievousness associated with popular conceptions of the devil. If you wanted to bypass the intelligentsia and the church, remain undetectable to the military system, leave undisturbed the political and administrative levels of a society, and at the same time implant deep within that society far-reaching doubts concerning its basic philosophical tenets, this is exactly how you would have to act. At the same time, of course, such a process would have to provide its own explanation to make ultimate detection impossible. In other words, it would have to project an image just beyond the belief structure of the target society. It would have to disturb and reassure at the same time, exploiting both the gullibility of the zealots and the narrow-mindedness of the debunkers. This is exactly what the UFO phenomenon does. Metalogic is the form of consistency found in statements like, "Does a unicorn have a horn in the middle of her forehead?" "Yes." "Is there such a thing as a unicorn?" "No." I have pointed out that the concept current among most flying saucer enthusiasts that the unidentified flying objects are simply craft used by visitors from another planet is naive. The explanation is too simple-minded to account for the diversity of the reported behavior of the occupants and their perceived interaction with human beings. Could this concept serve precisely a diversionary role in masking the real, infinitely more complex nature of the technology that gives rise to the sightings? Observations similar to the landing at Pascagoula, where two fishermen claimed to have been abducted by Klauman, have been made every year in the United States since 1947. A catalog of well-documented close encounter cases would hold the details of well over 2,000 cases of that type, from all countries, indicating that a formidable impact is being made on our collective psyche. Yet what trace has this produced on scientific efforts? A small one indeed, a few courageous astronomers are beginning to revise the probability estimates for other civilizations in space. Much is made of the possibility of detecting radio signals from other solar systems, and a few physicists are beginning to voice their doubts concerning Dr. Condon's biases. Against such a background, I am afraid that my own speculations may contradict both the ideas of the believers and the assumptions of the skeptics. Here, then, is a brief statement of five new propositions based upon the material we have reviewed so far. The things we call unidentified flying objects are neither objects nor flying. They can dematerialize, as some reliable photographs seem to show, and they violate the laws of motion as we know them. UFOs have been seen throughout history and have consistently received, or provided, their own explanation within the framework of each culture. In antiquity, their occupants were regarded as gods, in medieval times, as magicians, in the 19th century, as scientific geniuses, in our own time, as interplanetary travelers. Statements made by occupants of the 1897 airship included such declarations as "We are from Kansas" and even "We are from anywhere. But we'll be in Greece tomorrow." UFO reports are not necessarily caused by visits from space travelers. The phenomenon could be a manifestation of a much more complex technology. If time and space are not as simple in structure as physicists have assumed until now, then the question "where do they come from?" may be meaningless. They could come from a place in time. If consciousness can be manifested outside the body, then the range of hypotheses can be even wider. The key to an understanding of the phenomenon lies in the psychic effects it produces, or the psychic awareness it makes possible, in its observers. Their lives are often deeply changed, and they develop unusual talents with which they may find it difficult to cope. The proportion of witnesses who do come forward and publish accounts of these experiences is quite low. Most of them choose to remain silent. Contact between human percipients and the UFO phenomenon always occurs under conditions controlled by the latter. Its characteristic feature is a factor of absurdity that leads to a rejection of the story by the upper layers of the target society and an absorption at a deep unconscious level of the symbols conveyed by the encounter. The mechanism of this resonance between the UFO symbol and the archetypes of the human unconscious has been abundantly demonstrated by Carl Jung, whose book Flying Saucers makes many references to the age-old significance of the signs in the sky. I am not regarding the phenomenon of the UFOs as the unknowable, uncontrollable game of a higher order of beings. Neither is it likely, in my view, that an encounter with UFOs would add to the human being anything it did not already possess. Everything works as if the phenomenon were the product of a technology that followed well-defined rules and patterns, though fantastic by ordinary human standards. It has so far posed no apparent threat to national defense and seems to be indifferent to the welfare of individual witnesses, leading many to assume that we may be dealing with a still undiscovered natural occurrence. It cannot be intelligent, say some people, because it does not attack us. But its impact in shaping man's long-term creativity and unconscious impulses is probably enormous. The fact that we have no methodology to deal with such an impact is only an indication of how little we know about our own psychic world. Aviron, or the essence of prophecy. Two well-investigated cases have contained striking psychic elements. One took place in Aviron, France, and the other one in Kansas. They support the five propositions mentioned above. On June 15, 1966, in Aviron, a region of France situated near the Mid-Pyrenees, a 76-year-old woman made the first in a long and fascinating series of sightings on an isolated farm. The farmhouse itself is old, with 10 rooms whose windows face south and command an excellent view. "I was at the windows, just for a moment, because at my age you need a breath of air wherever you are. But never have I seen lights like that. Nor things like that. They weren't just lights, they were fires." The old woman became fearful, and the words she used to describe her anguish convey the precise feeling that many witnesses have tried to express in all languages: "All these fires, I'm too old, I don't want to see things like that. If this thing's going to move about like that, what's to become of us all?" Afterwards it moved again, over by the corner of the vineyard, you remember, speaking to her son-in-law, "That's when I called you, that's when I was frightened, but if that comes any closer, that's going to go in the barn and everything will go up in smoke, the house and us with it, so I called him. Mr. Fernand Lagarde, a local researcher who conducted a very thorough investigation of the events, reported that the haunting thought of fire frightens all country people, and so, distracted and scared, she calls her son-in-law to help, and later she will tell us that she went to bed fully clothed, for fear of what might be to come. This is a story with all the ring of truth about it. The fiery objects are spherical, and they cross the fields with deliberate motion. The son-in-law, who worked the farm, also observed what the old woman had seen, and went out to investigate. The objects, he said, were rounded on top and rather flattened underneath, and they vanished on the spot as if controlled by a switch. At one point there were six of them, less than a mile away. They moved in one line at the speed of a tractor, and they entered a larger luminous object that appeared as a sort of fiery tree, an illuminated shell. Everything disappeared, and the witnesses retired in complete puzzlement. This feeling was still very clear in the taped interviews I heard during a trip to France, and Lagarde confirmed that everything appeared to the witnesses disconcerting and irrational. The events went on in the calm night, without a sound, unreal, and dreamlike. The luminous spheres came back to the farm in Aveyron 6 months later, on January 6, 1967. The farmer had gone out to check on the animals when he suddenly saw one sphere not more than 50 yards away. He decided to get round behind that thing to see what it was, having assumed that it had a front and a back, but when he got outside the gate, the sphere was next to it, waiting for him. He had left it inside the yard a moment before. The man then decided to take a small path through the fields and again get behind that object, but the sphere proceeded to follow him over about 60 yards and went to block the entrance to the path. That there thing followed me for about 60 meters, near enough, and then there was a narrow bit where I wanted to get through, I did. So's to get round behind, then that followed me right along. Till I stopped there, where I wanted to get round behind, and the machine stops there too, right at the narrow bit. So I says, now. Ton's no use to argue. I can't get past. Coming back into the house, the farmer called his son, and going outside they saw six spheres this time and were so afraid that they went back inside the house. The larger shell-shaped object was there, too, and it was giving off a beam of light, as a searchlight would. There was a searchlight on top, right at the end of it, and it lit up that window up there. Lit up the whole room it did. I had the window open there opposite. Was it a diffused beam, or rather very concentrated? Oh, concentrated, very concentrated. And it lit up your room? Yes, lit it up all right. Off and on like. It was turning. Kept on turning. It was turning round and round, like a beacon? Yes, sometimes it lit up the next room down there. Kept on turning around. But there it was, 2300 hours already, maybe 2315, something like that. Then, sudden-like, everything died out. It all died out, and I didn't see anything more. I don't know if it had gone, or if it was still there. The culmination of the series of sightings in Aveyron took place on January 11, 1967, when the son saw the shell coming down near the house. He drove near it and could see that it was very large indeed. Two of the smaller spheres entered it, then it became very bright and the witness heard a whistling sound. The shell tilted at a 45-degree angle and was gone at an incredible speed. Another object came. It was shaped like a disc, with two transparent cupolas on top of it, and inside. Well now, inside. It seemed to me to be lit up inside with a green light. Inside the two domes. And I saw. Mind you, I can't be sure about this. It was very dark, you might have said there was some sort of fog, either inside or outside. Don't know which. Inside or outside the two domes. Anyway, I thought I saw two. Well, I saw two people like. Human beings, see? Cosmonauts? They wore overalls like aircrew, green trimmed with white. The object itself was hovering with a motion forward and back, pitching and rolling. The investigator asked, did you have the car door shut during this time? The response was, yes, yes. I must have opened the window, I think. Or perhaps it was afterwards, when it went off, that I opened the window. And then I felt a wave of heat, and I felt myself almost. I couldn't move hand or foot, for as long as it lasted. After about a week, the witness began to have trouble with his sleeping habits. He would sleep as much as 20 hours a day, and in spite of his parents' advice, he didn't want to consult a doctor. He simply couldn't stay on his feet when exhaustion hit him, and this went on for about 2 months. Something else happened to him in connection with his sleeping pattern. In the early morning hours, between 4 o'clock and 5 a.m. it seemed to him that he was floating off. His mind would be alert, although his body was paralyzed, and he would feel his consciousness leaving his body. In later conversations with the investigators, I learned of changes in the witness's behavior and belief system. He surprised everyone in this remote area of France by recommending to young people that they study astronomy and science in general with great care. And, in a private discussion with one of the researchers who have for several years followed up this remarkable case, he casually mentioned that he might soon have to write a book. It was pointed out to him that he could hardly write even the most simple letter. "They told me not to worry about that," he said. "When the time you're right, I will know what to put on paper." We are touching here the very essence of prophecy. They told him. But who are they? It seems that, in recurrent dreams since the incident with the flying disc, he has seen a number of men dressed in red and each holding a book and pointing at it. Nothing else happens in the dream. Just the men and the book. More recently, he has traveled over 200 miles to visit the investigator of this case, who had left precise instructions to keep him closely informed of any new and important development. When he was in the investigator's house, he did have something important to say, but he could not talk. The part of his brain that handled verbal expression and the mechanism of language could not process the data that he knew were there.
This is the end of Dimensions, a casebook of Alien Contact Part 8. A book by Jacques Vallée. Please proceed to Part 9, before YouTube deletes it. Thank you for listening.